Talk Pro. Well, today we're starting on an area of freelance that I think you really need to be aware of and be attentive about, because learning for the players, learning a freelance offense is not an easy thing. It takes time for one thing, but secondly, you have to do a good job as a coach of presenting it to them, and then on the day-to-day working through all the parts of the freelance. It's a journey, it's an excursion, but it's going to make you a better coach. It's going to make your players better. And remember this, they're doing it in the game anyway. Whether you teach them how to do it right, or you just throw them out there and let them do the best they can, because we have proven, and I've gone through so many games that I know it's a fact that your players are going to score about 70% of your points, and your opponents are too, in non-structured play. By non-structured, I also mean nothing. They have nothing. With the monk offense, you give them rules, and you give them organization, and you give them team play. But that's your job. It's not an easy one. And let me point out this. The freelance offense can be used with any offense. You don't have to change your set offense if you have something that really is good for you and you really like and you're comfortable with. That isn't the idea of it. It is run when you break down, either from a play or at the end of the fast break, or when you don't have anything. A big part of that is offensive rebounds, because you have them where you can just keep attacking them. And that's the beauty of this approach. When the defense is the weakest, you are in a position to keep attacking. You don't need to set up. You can just say one word and start running it at any time. And actually, it enhances set offenses. I feel like we always start the season learning the monk offense. Because when we go from the freelance offense to a set offense, which we do, we find it, they just have a better feel for playing in a more team-oriented, play-like situation. I like to call what we do plays. They're organized. I mean, they look like plays, but really they're just kind of part of a whole half-court offense against set defenses. But it can be used as an offense, and we do. For example, sometimes when we're really bogged down and they've kind of got an edge on defensively on what we're doing, a lot of times I'll just call monk and run it as a half-court offense, and that's how we're going to show you today. And it gives us more practice at it in game conditions. Now, what I'm going to do today is show you how we present it the very first practice of the season, of the preseason. And we always, everything we do, we show the whole thing first, and then we show the breakdown drills that accompany it. And when the players see the whole thing and are working with the whole thing, when they come to the breakdown drills, they see a connection. They know it relates. It becomes more important to them, other than what you probably do. You have a breakdown drill that doesn't relate at all to your offense, And the players are wondering, what, you know, what is this? And where do we work, what, use it? We're not going to use it in the game. But what we give them in the breakdown drills, they will understand right away, this is what we're going to have to be good at in the games, because this is what this offense is about. And pace. I want to talk to you about pace. I don't know how you do it, but I learned a long time ago that from team to team, even though you've got a lot of returning players, from team to team, the pace that is comfortable for the players, not for you, but for the players in a game, varies. My approach to that has always been to, at the beginning, kind of push them towards a little quicker pace, but eventually back off and let them find the pace that is comfortable for them. You have had much more success. I've had players that run freelance offense very fast, but that's the pace they're comfortable at. But the best team that I've ever had running this offense, freelance and the cut series, was excruciatingly slow. They weren't slow players. In fact, they were quick players. But their pace was very slow. And I just let them do that. You know, that it was comfortable for them. They could execute better at that pace. As a team, they just fell into it. Well, now I'm going to take you up on the board and show you how we present it and make some comments on it and show you how that, that you know, you should be looking at presenting it. Because I think it's no sense trying to think you know everything. You know, listen to a guy who's done it for 30 years, you'll learn a lot more. Because he wouldn't be doing it for 30 years if it wasn't working for him. So it does work. So now let's go to the board. Here's how we start when we introduce the freelance offense. This is not how they will start most of the time in a game. They're going to start from all over the place. But if we find it easier to develop some organization for them, if we start, and we actually start our freelance offense, Monk, in the same way we start our set offense. When we go to the cut series, we start, out of a two-guard front. Now, some of you may like to run a one-guard front, and that's okay. You can do it with a one-guard front. You'd have to adjust this a little bit, but, you know, that's no problem, except I will tell you this. I've done it both ways. You know, Jerry Sloan and Phil Johnson, who had a great offense, when they had Stockton, they had a one guard front offense, of course, because he was so good. But Phil Johnson, who really architects the whole thing, told me that, he said, I'll just tell you that it works better with a two guard front. And I have found that to be true also. We put them in these positions because it looks like our set offense. So if we use this offense in a game, this is how we'd line up. It's very difficult for the opponents to recognize whether we're going to be in Monk or in our cut series. And a lot of time, and you'll see when we go along, it gets very confusing for them because we allow the players to change it a lot, just about like they do in football when they go to the line of scrimmage. And this is what they do, and they must do this. They don't have to dribble, but usually they use it in order to get a better position. Make sure these guys are cutting up and getting the ball out here, not just walking over here and then they get out here someplace. You know, discipline them to do this correctly. It makes everything a lot easier. Well, when they, every time in both offenses, both the cut and the monk, they hit the wing and cut through. Okay, and both of them, whether it's cut or a monk. Now, this cut right through there, you have already penetrated their defense. One simple cut, and you're into their defense. So now, here comes the difference, though. Cut, pass, cut. Let me talk about this a little bit. Your inexperienced players will have trouble to see this guy open. This cut is one of the best in basketball without the ball, and the pass is short. These guys get open a lot. The trouble is, this guy doesn't see them, or he's not experienced enough to be able to make that pass. But if he does make the pass, it's almost always a layup. And, you know, at the end of a game on our offense, this is going to happen maybe 50, 55 times. Well, you know, they're going to make a mistake. They're going to start to trail this guy, and then it's all over. You just pass and he gets layup. Now we run a high post man, and our high post man, and we encourage a lot of guard-to-guard passes if there's any kind of resistance over there that we can't handle. His rule is to always play in line with the ball. If the ball's over here, he's over here. If the ball goes back over there, he goes back over here. We don't have him there as a screener, but they can use him as a screener. We just don't allow them to, you know, stutter step and everything to get them on that screen. That's not important. What's important is passing. Cut hard and penetrate that defense and start to get them scrambled, which it does. Now, we use this offense, by the way, against the zone. That's all we do. You can run this right, you'll kill zone defenses. This cut's gotta, we do that against the zone too, we make that cut. So that's the beginning of it. Okay, now here is the catch. When we introduce it, we do this, pass, cut. And when I demonstrate that, I don't do it myself anymore. When we get through that, I tell the players, and this is what shocks them, and most coaches hate to even say it, but I tell them, now you're on your own. Do whatever you want. That's it. That's our offense. That's all I got. From now on, you're the offense. They don't know what to do, and they can't let up enough to really be loose enough to do it. And we understand that at first, but coaches get a little shell shocked on that. You know, whoa, they're going to do whatever they want to do. Well, we have rules. Now, with rules, let me explain that we do not hand out rules. I have a very specific reason for this. I don't want them trying to memorize the rules, because in a game, you know, your memory can get pretty goofy in a highly contested. I want them to feel what they are to do, not have to stop and think, what's the rule now? And do it from memory. Here's how we teach them. When we first come out, you know, we, the first time we show them this, and we get to here, I stop them, and then I tell them, because I can tell by the look in their eyes, what am I supposed to do? They don't know. They've never had that kind of freedom before. So I show them just two of the rules. The rules I usually show, but not always, depending on the team. You know, if most of my team is veteran, I probably approach it a little bit different. If they are new to it, then, you know, I generally go to these rules. I show them first. I tell them what they can do when they get the ball. And our rule is, when you get the ball, look to shoot. But don't shoot unless you got a shot. Here you get into, can get into a little trouble. You know, I don't have much problem with that, but I've seen coaches that try it, and they do. This guy just catches it, and you said to shoot. Well, we're talking about get ready to shoot, because in this offense, you want this player with the ball to look, be looking in. He's got to make a position where he's turned towards the basket to shoot. But it also puts him in a position to see cutters, because they don't know where the cuts are coming from. All of a sudden, the guy cuts in, he's open. You've got to be prepared to get that ball in. So we want them always to looking here. So, the first, and the other reason is, if you're going to get open for a shot, it's going to be probably within 1 second after you get the ball. So you should come into the ball, wherever it is, prepared to shoot first. Because after if you don't, if you're looking to drive first, you will never get a shot. Then you look to drive. That's number two. Look to shoot, look to drive. And third is look to pass. Because if you don't have a drive, you don't have a shot, you don't have a drive, you're looking in here to pass. That's the pass we would prefer. Coming here is a non-penetrating pass, but a pass in here penetrates that, defense. And then I tell them that you never pass, except for an open man, for three counts. One, two, three. Because I know what is popular now. I see it and I cringe. You know, pass, pass, pass. As quick as you get the ball, pass it. It looks nice. You know, the crowd loves it. Even in practice, you're going to feel good. God, I'm really passing the ball. But when you're passing the ball, there's all kinds of opportunities down here. So we say, keep the ball for three counts. And look, give your teammates a chance to break into the open. Now, if they can't pass in here, then we, you know, in our rules, we provide for there should be a man out here all the time. That then they can pass after three counts to keep things moving. That's what they do with the ball. I also show them the rule. I tell them this is one of the rules. When you're away from the ball and don't have the ball, then you should look to screen. All right, this guy is away from the ball, right? He can look, this is one of the parts of the rule, to screen. He might come over here and screen. He might screen over here. This guy might screen. We don't know, but that's what they can do away from the ball. Or they can cut to the ball or to the basket. By cutting to the basket would be this kind of cut. Cutting to the ball would be this kind of cut. We work with our players. They know what I'm talking about when I say that. After they've gone through our breakdown drills. Okay, we also tell them, number three, screen, cut, or fill. This is a fill. The ball's here. It's a non-penetrating movement. We allow it because this guy's got to have a pass back. So whoever's over here, we don't care who does it, somebody's got to come and fill so we can reverse the ball. Now this man is not staying in the post. He can do just like he's an outside player. The minute the pass, he's now an outside player. So he can come over here and screen. He can cut to the basket. He can come back here and screen. All of these things are possible for him. When a man is in the post up, this is another rule. They're learning these rules by me telling them at the time. I want them to learn it that way, not by memory. So we have a rule for a post up man. 3 counts and you got to go out. Because these big guys, they just sit in here and jam everything up. We want them out. You know, they have to learn how to play outside. They will. If you work with them, they will. So this, we say, is a post-up position. High post, low post, post away. Same rules. They have the same exact rules. Okay. Now, pass, cut. I say, they now know they can do whatever they want to do. But they got to remember those 3 rules, at least. We got much more. But because they kind of assimilate the rules, rather than memorize the rules, they remember them better in a game. This is why this is such a terrific offense. Think of what you're teaching these guys right now and giving them an opportunity to work. I mean, we have NBA guys that don't know that much. The simple things that, you know, can be done. Now they go and run until they either take a shot and miss it, or they screw it up, or whatever. What I do is I have 5 players or another team here, say dark here, these are white, they get done. Dark has a ball. I make a big point of this. That one of those guards better have a ball. And the minute these guys are done, they come on. I go one possession at a time. I don't keep these guys out here forever and those guys sitting there forever. They get the same amount of possessions on when we're working on that. And that's what we do. Now, for your peace of mind, I'm going to tell you right out that they're going to look awful. They're going to look awful. They're going to not know what to do. They're going to, and what they do is going to be very slow because they're thinking all the time. They're sitting over here, and I had this question once from a coach and a player talked to him about it. Said, "I just feel like there's nothing I can do. I'm just standing there." Well, they shouldn't be standing there. They will give them enough rules and give them enough practice. They should never be just standing there. Everybody's free to move and do something. But it doesn't look good. In fact, I have to say it looks ugly. Even when you get, players will do better when you get a defense because they've got something to anchor them. Once they start moving a little bit and doing things, it'll still look really ugly. But you know what the beauty of it is? It thrills me to the bone. All of a sudden they're milling around out there, everything is looking bad, and boom, a guy cuts in, little shot right here, and it's in, or a layup. And that's what we're trying to get. We don't care about form. We don't care about appearance. What we care about is putting that ball in the basket and getting our players the best shot to do that. This is a team. You're learning how to play as a team when you can do this. Now, I want to make sure on my notes. Yes, one important thing. Coach, do not direct players. Do not say, well, when you pass there, one, and you come up here, one, come up and set a pick here, or set a pick over here, or you set a pick. You're making plays. Then run plays. This isn't plays. You can't direct them like it. Yes, you can show them possibilities. I don't do that very early. I want them to just mull around out there until they get used to it. And they'll learn. Listen, these are not dumb guys. They'll figure things out by themselves. And then that's really the heart of learning. Talking to them is not learning. What they are learning, doing by themselves, that is learning. And the players will do it. They will want to run plays. Here's what, I'm just showing you one thing that I've seen a lot. Pass, cut, he comes over here, sets a screen, he comes off, boom, he gets a layup. Now, the next five times they run it, they do the same thing. They're running a play. So you have to correct them, you know. And you think, well, if it's working, but it's working maybe a time or two, but now you're getting into being predictable if he does this all the time. You have to get him, he'll want to do it because it's comfortable to him, but you got to get him out of that comfort zone. You got to get him doing different things. Otherwise, you're just going to have plays that they make up themselves. Well, we got a long ways to go on this, but this is the start. It's simple. It's a very simple start, but that's what we do. But then we start putting in breakdown plays that show them different ways they can screen, different ways they can cut, and then all of a sudden this starts to really throb and get going. And I will tell you this. This is not how you're going to run the Monk offense in a game. Because what you're going to run in a game is you're coming down on a fast break, they stop the fast break. We want a seamless action. Okay, we ran the fast break, we didn't get it, now I'm not going to pull it out. I'm just going to hit the wing and cut, and you're in Monk. Or you run a play, it breaks down, instead of backing off, wondering, you just hit, cut, and you're in Monk. So they're going to start the offense maybe from over here or down here, wherever. But we don't want there to be a gap. Break down, stand and watch, and then start. We want it to be a flow through there. Play breaks down, no sweat. Pass, cut. They don't have to bring the ball back out. We don't, in fact, we tell them not to, and we insist on it. Well, that's the beginning. It's going to be a lot of fun. So we'll see you in a couple days, and we'll just keep going on this. We'll get to everything after a while. See you next time. Thanks.